Thank you, Nicole. Hi, everyone. Thank you a lot for joining today. It's very nice to see so many people here. So today I'm gonna talk to you about my own area of research, that is first impression of trustworthiness from faces. So imagine you walk in a room. And the first two unfamiliar people you see around are those two presented here. My question to you is, who would you approach first? Well, probably you are gonna approach first the person on the left because she seems more friendly and maybe even more trustworthy looking. What I would like you to notice here is actually how easy it was for you to form this kind of impression. So today's discussion will be all on trustworthiness impressions. First, I will explain which are the consequences of trust impressions in our everyday life. Then we will talk about which facial cues do we use to form these kind of impressions. Then I will answer to this question on whether they are accurate or not. A question I really get asked a lot, and it's super interesting to talk about this with you today. And finally, I will talk to you about how trust impressions of groups are made. That is basically what I'm working on at the moment. So, let's start. Which are the consequences in real life of trust impressions? Well, we know that, for example, more trustworthy looking Airbnbs are more popular on Airbnb. So, having a trustworthy looking face on Airbnb can have, in the end, also a financial impact for you. For romantic attraction, although physical attractiveness is obviously very important in determining which we like, who we like and who we don't, romantic attraction is also influenced by trustworthiness appearance. Also, we know that trustworthy looking researchers are usually perceived as doing good science compared to untrustworthy looking researchers. Most problematically, we know that trustworthiness impressions plays a role also in situations where we really wouldn't like them to play a role. For example, in criminal system justice, there are studies showing that people with a trustworthy looking face are more likely to be trusted and less likely to be convicted, and vice versa for untrustworthy looking faces. And also regarding job hiring, some research showed, especially in CEOs, that trustworthiness, facial appearance really influence leadership selection and compensation. So, since the early 20th century, psychology really started to investigate which are the facial characteristics that make a face look trustworthy or not. And since that time, we really knew that people kind of agree, and there is a large consensus on how we form these kind of impressions. And from this research, emotional expressions were highlighted as a very important cue that we use to extract social attributions from faces, even when the faces are actually emotionally neutral. Indeed, the emotional overgeneralization hypothesis argues that people detect very subtle resemblance to emotion in the structural of neural faces. And then basically they end up overgeneralizing these cues to make trait evaluation about other people's personality. So, for example, faces that even if they are not smiling, they have some facial characteristics that make the face look appearing more smiley, such as surprised looking eyebrow or a Upworth U-shaped mouth. Well, these faces will appear more approachable and thus more trustworthy looking. On the other hand, people with some facial features that resemble angry emotional expression, for example, low inner eyebrows, are perceived as more untrustworthy because they seem less approachable and kind of angry at you. However, impressions of trust do not depend only on objective morphological characteristics from faces, but there are also other non-perceptual factors that influence how we form impressions of trust. For example, face typicality is one of these. We know now that atypical faces are usually judged as more untrustworthy. And this really could make us think because face typicality is really different wherever you go. It's different between cultures and nations. So it happens that it is greater familiarity with ones in group race that can shift how then we perceive typicality in faces. And this can result eventually in an on-race positivity bias. So we tend to judge people of our race as more positively. Another very important factor is social categorization. So the idea is that we use perceptual features to assign a face to a social category, and we evaluate it accordingly to the beliefs that we have about that particular social category. A very classic example of this is gender. So we know that trustworthiness impressions are usually more positive toward females. Females are usually perceived as more trustworthy looking. What we also know is that gender informations are kind of interpreted differently in if you're looking to a female or a male. For example, our research showed that counter-stereotypical females, so females that have a kind of masculine face appearance, are perceived usually as less trustworthy compared to gender stereotypical faces and also counter-stereotypical males. This effect is really related to the beliefs about women that society has, and it is in line with the backlash effect. So, is that effect that you have usually in working environments, and it basically female workers that act in a more masculine way to be judged more harshly and negatively. Then also, when you meet a person that really reminds you of another person, well, you might start thinking that they share kind of their personality. So also resemblance with significant others is another important effect that we see in trustworthiness impression. And finally, we also know that faces similar to our own face are usually rated as more trustworthy. This might be due because we usually have a positive self-view bias. So we usually, this is a very interesting psychological phenomenon for which we basically usually think that we are on average more trustworthy and honest compared to the rest of the people. So, a question that I really get asked a lot is, are these impressions actually accurate? Should I use them? Should I not? Well, even if some of these cues could have a small kernel of truth, there is really little evidence that first impression of trust are accurate enough to be functional and to be used in our everyday life. And usually, as we saw, these kind of facial evaluations are really based on minimal information from faces, for example, subtle emotional expression, that then end up being overweighted in decisions. So, what we can think about trust impressions as a sort of visual heuristic that we use to form sophisticated but also inaccurate expectation about another person behavior and how they are gonna act toward us. And also, even if we could find evidence that the facial morphology is a valid predictor of a certain trait, this really does not imply a direct biological link between that particular facial trait and the personality. Indeed, the self-fulfilling prophecy effect might happen. This effect implies that others' expectations and beliefs on a person can eventually influence how they interact with that person, causing their beliefs to come true. An example of this is attractive children. Research showed that attractive children are also seen as smarter by teachers, and teachers, if we take into account the self-fulfilling prophecy effect, might eventually start giving more challenging tasks to attractive children. And in the end, these attractive children might end up becoming smarter for real. And this could happen also for first impression of trust. For example, a person that has a really untrustworthy looking face might be more discriminated and might end up eventually to become more aggressive. So far, research investigated individual facial characteristics that make a face appear more or less trustworthy by using mainly isolated and contextualized images. However, in everyday life, we usually don't perceive faces in isolation. Instead, we perceive faces embedded in a social and spatial context. Recent studies in visual science investigated group perception by showing that we are able to form impressions, also a group of faces, for a lot of different facial characteristics, such as expression, identity, and attractiveness. This phenomenon is called ensemble perception. A lot of past research in ensemble perception used this kind of stimuli that you are seeing here today. So basically, they were faces presented in a kind of Zoom call structure before even Zoom existed and was essential basically in our everyday life. And this is very fun because these guys did it right at the time. Actually, it's as if we are now, sorry, now it's as if we are basically in their own experiment because we spend our everyday life zooming around kind of a lot. Which is ensemble perception? Well, in natural scenes, usually there are a big amount of objects that are similar and redundant. For example, if you look at this image here, you can see that the color of the tree. You immediately understand that it's green without the need to look at each single leaf on the tree. Or also by looking at the people there, they are clearly cheering the bikers that maybe finally arrived after a long run. You really don't need to look at each single face to understand their emotional expression and their joyness. The idea is that our visual system, instead of analyzing each single redundant stimulus in our visual environment, basically calculates summary statistics of similar items. And this phenomenon occurs also for faces. Also, imagine when you enter a Zoom meeting or also just a social meeting in person, you really don't need to look at each single face in the group for understanding the mood of the crowd. You just enter and you immediately get the mood if the crowd is interested, if they are happy, sad, and so on. And a lot of facial features can be integrated in an ensemble perception. So we can get the gist of a group of faces from four different characteristics. For example, for emotional expression, as I just said, or regarding the sex ratio of the crowd, or the facial identity, or even the attractiveness. But what about trustworthiness impressions? Are we able to get the gist of the scene related to how much trust on average is the group or not? Well, as I told you before, there is a lot of research that investigated trustworthiness impressions by looking just at single individual faces. So we know a lot about one-to-one interactions and how we form impressions of other single individuals, but still we don't know a lot about groups of people. And actually, that's a pity because in our everyday life we don't have just one-to-one interaction, but we also meet, of course, groups of people. And this might be relevant also for then how we behave toward that group. For example, imagine to walk at night on a dimly lit road in Aberdeen. And you meet these two groups. You need to decide very fastly in which side of the street to walk. Should you walk on the left toward the Peaky Blinders, or should you go on the right toward the French people? Well, you see that in a situation like that, it's important to extract really the gist of the scene and the gist of the group of people you are looking at without the need of looking at each single face, because you probably wouldn't even have a lot of time to look at them. And understanding the average level of trust of a crowd could actually also influence how we judge single members of a particular group, because when we form an average ensemble perception of a group for a certain characteristics, we basically don't see anymore individuals' faces as if they are alone, but we see individual faces in relation to the average level of trust of the group. This might be relevant for police lineups. In police lineups, you see a series of possible criminals in line. So basically, what you see is a group of faces all together. And we still don't know whether looking at all the faces together might influence the perception of trust of individual single faces. And on a lighter note, another example of how a group impression can be misleading is the BBC TV show The Traitors. Probably some of you just saw it. For those who have never seen it, basically the idea of the show is that a group of people is divided secretly in the traitors and the faithfuls. And the goal of the traitors is to secretly banish all the faithful from the game. But anyone in this TV show will just pretend to be a faithful. And so the idea is that in this TV show, trust and understanding who to trust is really, really the main and core important topic. And here, regarding how we form group impressions, all participants will, of course, try to act and look in a very trustworthy looking and smiley way. So we might get an average impression of the group as if they are kind of all very trustworthy. And we might also fail to understand who is the traitor, who should not trust, also because of this. Or on the contrary, we might become super very suspicious toward anyone, and we might perceive everyone just as so untrustworthy that we might struggle to understand who eventually to trust. So, here at the University of Aberdeen, we decided to investigate whether we are able to extract an ensemble perception of trustworthiness from multiple faces. And we investigated this topic by running four online experiments. So, these are the faces that we showed to participants. They are computer-generated faces created to vary in their level of trustworthiness. So, there were faces that were quite low in trustworthiness, the faces on the left, and then we morphed them up to faces that were quite high in trustworthiness. So in the first experiment, we showed on the screen for 2 seconds different set of faces. So there were set of 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 faces. And all these faces were randomly extracted from one continuum of identities. So they had basically kind of a similar identity. And then we asked the participants to indicate the average level of trustworthiness of these groups of faces. And participants were asked to do this with an adjustment task. So a face appeared on the screen and they needed to click on the left or right keys to select from the entire morph continuum the face that matched in their view the average level of the previously seen faces. So here we were very interested in understanding whether participants were actually integrating the whole set of faces in a summary statistic instead of subsampling just one face from the code and indicating the average level of trust just by looking at one single face. So basically, in this task, there could have been two possible strategies that participants used. One, as shown here, is subsampling, the other one is integration. We really wanted participants to use integration as a strategy because integration really reflects the fact that ensemble perception were occurring. So we needed an experimental condition to really be sure that they were integrating all the faces. So we measured how much participants integrated the trust of the whole set of faces by presenting on each trial groups with different set size conditions to simulate their performance in the case in which they were just subsampling a few items from the set of faces. So here you see that in some trials just one face was presented, in other trials just 3, 4, or 5, and so on. So now I will explain you exactly all the details of this. The idea is that on each trial, a random face from an identity morph continuum was selected. For example, here was the morph 20. And this face, we will call this face the average face. Then, 5 more faces around this mean were selected. Now, in some trials, in the set size 5 trials, all of these 5 faces were shown to participants. In the other set sizes conditions, just a subset of these faces were shown. So in set size 4, just 4 out of 5 faces, and so on, up to set size 1, when just one face was displayed, basically. So here, to understand whether observers were integrating or not, we calculated their response error from the mean relative to the 5 items, so the initially selected mean, not the mean displayed on the screen. The main idea of this analysis is that the more information is given across set sizes, with the increase in the number of faces displayed from the set, the more, if participants were integrating, the responses should have become more and more similar to the initially extracted set size 5 mean. Otherwise, if the response would have remained distant from this mean across all the set size conditions, well, this would be an index of subsampling. Well, I know that this analysis is very detailed and also complex, so don't you worry if you didn't understood all the details of this. What I just would like you to remember is that the graph on the left, this integration graph here, is what we would expect to find in our data if people were showing integration. Thus, if people were showing basically ensemble perception to groups of faces related to trustworthiness. If we observe this kind of trend in the data, well, this would mean that just ensemble perception couldn't happen for trustworthiness impressions in groups. So let's have a look at the data now. These are the results of experiment one. In this first graph, you just see the response error of participants, the average response error. Basically, here we just wanted to be sure that participants were able to do the task. So we calculated the chance performance of participants in doing the task, and we just saw that participants had a performance below the chance level. So it means that they were actually able and good in doing this task. And then we just calculated whether participants were integrating. And here in this graph, you can see that this trend matched the integration effect. So happily, we just concluded that observers were successfully able to extract the average level of trust from the set of faces in this adjustment task. However, we used this adjustment task that was very, very helpful, but participants were just asked to adjust the facial appearance of the face. So basically, in this task, we didn't really ask them to express a trustworthiness rating per se. That's why we ran experiment two. In experiment two, participants were asked to do a rating task instead of an adjustment task. So this time they basically rated from 1 to 50 how much the average level of trust of the previously seen faces. And the results are similar to experiment one. So we found that participants were actually good at doing the task and they were able to integrate all the trustworthiness information in just an ensemble perception. Then we ran a third experiment. Indeed, in experiment one and two, we showed groups of faces from the same identity continuum morph. So one could say that the ensemble perception effect that we found could be based on the overall identity similarity. For this reason, in experiment three, on each trial, different identities were shown. So there were both faces varying in levels of trustworthiness and in identity. And the task was always the same, so it was a rating task. And still, similar results, participants were able to do the task and we found an integration effect. Finally, we were curious about understanding how quickly it is possible to form this kind of ensemble perception of trust from a group. Does it require seconds, milliseconds? We were curious about that. For this reason, we ran a final experiment. In this experiment, there were different exposure conditions. So basically, we showed participants the groups of faces for 2 seconds, 1 second, 500 milliseconds, 250, 150 milliseconds. So 50 milliseconds, you can realize that it's very, very fast. It's kind of like a flash. And then we asked the participants again to indicate the average level of trustworthiness of the faces that they previously saw. So from this experiment, we calculated the ability to integrate our participants for each stimulus duration. Here the analysis is slightly different, but we can interpret this graph just by looking at how much these lines are tilted. If the line that you see is tilted, it means that participants were actually integrating the trustworthiness information in an ensemble perception. If the line is flat, the more it is flat, the more they were actually not able to integrate. And from this graph, we can see that participants were able to form a summary statistic of trustworthiness from a group up to 250 milliseconds. So it means that 250 milliseconds, which is very, very fast, it's enough for us to form a first impression of a group, basically. Okay, so to wrap up, today we talked about the consequences in everyday life of trustworthiness impressions, of which are the facial cues that are involved in this kind of impressions, whether they are accurate or not. And then we move to how face impressions of trust are made in groups. And we just go through evidences of ensemble perception in trust impressions. So I think I talked enough for today. I would like to thank my amazing PhD supervisor, Dr. Mauro Manassi and Claire Sutherland. And of course, thank you all for your attention. Now I'm very happy to take any question. Thank you.
That was absolutely fascinating. Thank you so much for taking the time to share that with us. I just find this whole topic just absolutely, as I said, fascinating. We've got, as I said before, the chat is, you can find it in the Collaborate panel. So if you haven't opened it yet, it's that purple icon in the bottom right-hand corner and a speech bubble. And then you'll be able to type your questions in there. And we have got lots of time for questions. Robin has asked the first question, so I'll read it out for Robin. It says, how much do you think environmental factors might impact our judgment on this? To use your example, would the context of a police lineup bias us to thinking the participants are less trustworthy despite the trustworthiness of their faces?
Oh, yeah, that's a very, very interesting question. And actually, there is a line of research starting to investigate this. And in a recent experiment, they just showed the same face, but with different backgrounds. For example, I remember seeing a background of a kind of very naturalistic scene, very relaxing, or a background of a kind of murder scene, very, very aggressive and violent. And people actually were very influenced by the background, so the environment behind the face. And the same face was rated lower in trustworthiness, of course, for the more violent background. And yeah, definitely, I agree that probably police lineups might be influenced also by the context itself. And also, in police lineups, you are not allowed to smile. And as we saw today, smiling, it's a really important cue of trustworthiness. So I think on a baseline, in police lineups, people appear definitely more untrustworthy compared to other more relaxed situations, for sure.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. Okay, the next question is, what is the next stage of your research?
So in my research in this period, I'm starting to focus more on how impression of trust are influenced by temporal events that happened in the past. So let's say this experiment was focused more on how the spatial context influence trustworthiness impressions. Now I'm getting more interested in see whether the faces that we saw before in the temporal context are influenced by, I mean, they influence the faces, the perception of the faces that you are looking in the present.
Very interesting. Thank you for that. The next person says, surely clothes must be very relevant too.
Yeah, no, definitely. Let's say that for a lot of years, the research focused a lot on facial impression themselves, but there is a huge context of cues that can influence our impression for sure. For example, there is a bit of research on clothes, but also other cues from people. For example, voices seem to be able to influence how much we look trustworthy or not. Or also our posture, our non-verbal language can have definitely an impact.
Okay, thank you. The next person saying, will AI and deep fakes affect our innate ability to trust, in your opinion? And this person is assuring us that they are not AI.
Well, definitely that's a very interesting question because in just these recent years, a lot of research has been done also on how we perceive AI faces. And from research, we just found that we are really bad at distinguishing a real face from an AI face. So I just get your concern on the fear to not be able to distinguish them and not understanding who you can trust or not. Definitely, I think that could be problematic, especially online. In online context, that's definitely a sensible concern.
Yes, AI in general is a bit scary sometimes. Oh, we've got somebody coming on. Oh, they disappeared again. There was someone came onto the screen there. I think they're okay. I was going to ask a question. You touched on before about juries and, in criminal cases, and the trustworthiness of faces. Has there been in-depth research carried out to determine if, that if someone's face was more trustworthy, but they turned out to be guilty, do you get what I mean? Is there any sort of direct correlation between how someone looks versus their guilt or innocence?
Yeah, there is a research on this, and actually they found that there was not a big correlation between how much the convicted person was trustworthy or not. The only correlation was in the level of facial untrustworthiness appearance and the severity of the conviction. So that was really, really clear, but not clear the relationship between the actual guilt.
Okay. The next one is, why do you think we have developed, sorry, why do you think we have developed of this group judgment on trustworthiness?
Well, I think in general, when we meet groups of people, we just try very fastly to understand who we have in front of us. That's just a natural, our natural tendency that we have both with the individuals and both with groups of people. And it comes from the same place. So the idea of trying to predict what the behaviors of others. With that said, I don't think that we developed itself the ability to understand whether a person is trustworthy or not, because if we think about evolution itself, our brain didn't develop in an environment that is any similar to the one in which we live today. In fact, we may be used to living in very smallest social groups. There were not a lot of strangers that we met every time. So there was really not a big need to form this kind of impressions toward strangers. What was needed, though, was the ability to read the emotional expressions of others. So understanding whether others liked me, smiled at me, or were maybe angry at me. So evolution really shaped our ability to understand other emotional expression. And forming first impressions from faces might be a sort of a side effect of evolution, because we really based our judgment of very subtle cue of emotional expression, as we saw in the study that I presented before. So yeah, it's difficult to say. It's usually difficult to say what is evolutionally shaped or side effect, but that's my view at least.
Thank you. So interesting. The next question is, what could be done to reduce the negative effect of bias, for like example, before court or in school?
Well, that's a very important question. I still don't know 100% the answer, and I find it very difficult to imagine a practical solution for this. What I know is the previous research tried to diminishing this kind of visual biases. But the results are not very encouraging. Let's say that different things can be done more practically. For example, I'm thinking about orchestra selections of musicians. Usually there is now this practice of having blind selections. So basically, people, examiners, are just listening to the music, and they are not literally seeing who is playing. So that might be a way to reduce this kind of biases. Or also, I like their, especially in the UK, the fact that for CVs, you really don't use photos of people, because when you just put a photo of yourself in your CV, you really can influence other people. People might start to have a first impression of you without even arriving to the job interview. So that might be very good if you have a fantastic face, very trustworthy looking, but might be also harmful if you maybe are just not very trustworthy looking in that particular face. So I think also that is a good I think it's a good practice.
Okay, thank you. And we've got quite an interesting scenario for the next question. So it's how long do you think it takes, to evaluate, sorry, an untrustworthy face in a familiar crowd? So for example, your brother introduces you to their friends and all of them look trustworthy, but one looks untrustworthy or like a criminal. And can you recognize the untrustworthy face in the first impression, or is it diluted by the rest of the trustworthy and good-looking faces?
Yeah, that's a very, very interesting question. I think that probably it might have the more untrustworthy looking face, if it's very, very different from the rest of the faces in the group, might also pop out. So might be perceived more strongly. This is because, in a way, ensemble perception is also a mechanism that our visual system utilizes to reduce noise in the visual scene. So basically, we group together more redundant stimuli, so stimuli that are more similar to each other. So I could imagine that variance in the group of people, so having a group with very extremes, untrustworthy looking people and trustworthy looking people, can be noticed. So probably I would say that you would notice fastly, but still I didn't test this directly, so I don't know. But that's what I would predict. Would be a nice experiment, I think.
That's excellent. Thank you very much. That's the last question in the chat. So just if you've got anything else, you've got still got time. If you want to type anything else in, we'll give you just a couple more minutes. I was just going to ask you that obviously this is your area of expertise, you know a lot about it. Do you think if you participated in the Traitors TV show, do you think this would give you an edge?
So I think I would just start to look very suspiciously at all the faces of all the people. So I don't know. I would be probably the person silently looking at all the others and just try to understand and study them. So I don't know. Probably I would have been just banished the first day because of this. I don't know.
Someone said, which I take it you watched The Traitors, Yametta. You watched the yes. Someone said that you would manage to spot Diane and Ross, the
Definitely,
mother and
definitely.
son. Definitely. Okay then, I think that's all the questions. So just thank you so much for taking the time to share that with us today. It's so appreciated.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And I hope everybody has a lovely weekend. And hopefully you'll join us at another online event soon. Take care.